My castle away. Playtime, welcome to Playtime. It's been a long week since last week. I don't know about for you, but for me, it's been a testing week, and it's great to get back to the Playtime stage. And we have some wonderful guests with us tonight. We have on saxophone the amazing Matt Carmichael. Woo! And Graham can't be here tonight, so we only managed to get Fergus McCready on the piano as a replacement. And we have Martin Kershaw on saxophone as well. He was on the stage for 1 week, and that was because somebody texted my landline to get him on the stage, but we haven't had any requests for him to be on the stage this week, so he's back down, back down there. And on the bass, Mario, could he be? He's handsome, he's talented. He's from Brazil, ladies and gentlemen. And we have the amazing Matt Elliott on sound and vision. He's been having a tough week as well. So, and we have Rory, our fashion guru, Rody. You can't see, but one of these, I think I put, no, I need to put photos up of Rory. Okay, so I'm gonna pass over to Matt to tell us about this first tune that we're going to play. Or does it, do you want to do? We're going to go straight into it, and this tune is called The Airport.
Thank you. Thanks very much. That was a tune called The Airport, featuring Martin Kershaw on piano. No, Martin Kershaw. No, that's a lie. Featuring Martin Kershaw on alto saxophone, Tom Bancroft on the drums, Fergus McCready on the piano, and Mario Caribe on the double bass. Yeah, thanks very much for tuning in. I've been watching, I've been checking out a lot of these Playtime streams, and it's a wonderful thing they're doing, and it's nice to be a part of it this week. Next tune we're going to play is one called Conan Bridge, which is a rural town near Inverness where I spent the early years of my life. So this is Conan Bridge. Thank you. Mario. thanks very much. That was fantastic playing from Martin Kershaw there. So fantastic that it'd be great if there was maybe a tiny bit more alto saxophone in the monitor. next tune, well, yeah, that was Conan Bridge.
Matt, I was just gonna say about some people that are watching. So we've got Roz Rigby watching, Donna Andrews, Ivan Clark, who's our audience member of 2020. Who's making a strong showing in 21. And we've got Donna Andrews, Miriam Owen. Do you know Donna Andrews?
I know her through the internet. I think she ordered a CD.
Okay.
Send one over to Canada? Or maybe it's Los Angeles.
Are you in Canada? And did you get
your CD?
Oh, brilliant. Tony Dolly Evans is watching from Cheltenham Jazz Festival. No. You should know Tony. He's a good guy to know. Yes, yeah. So Adrian Collins watching. Everyone's writing in saying they're watching. So, Matt, what are we doing next?
We are doing a tune called Here by Martin Kershaw. I don't have any information to further information about the title. Maybe Martin can type some on Facebook or something, I don't know. But yeah, this is Here by the fantastic Martin Kershaw.
Just going to tell you that Donna has responded and she's received the CD. But where are you, Donna? Are you in Los Angeles or Canada?
Thank you.
Yeah, what a tune by Martin Kershaw. That was called Here. And that's where we are. Until we go over there. Then we'll be there. But we'll also be here when we're there. So, Matt, Donna Andrews is in California, near San Francisco, California area. She got her CD. She didn't say anything about the packaging, though. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. Ivan Clark said, "This kid is all over that thing." Mario. No. We're not quite sure who that was referring to, but there was a thing and there's a kid, and the kid is all over that thing. Frank Ken said, "Great tune." Dave Mulligan's watching. He said, "Whoop." Don Andrew says,
"Hi, Dave."
Oh, there's discussions going on between the audience members on a chat about whether she's wearing flowers in her hair, being from San Francisco. And she says, "Not today." That may be a reference to too young for. It's a 60s thing. You weren't alive in the 60s, were you?
No.
Not even in a previous life. Okay, so. I'm going to stop talking rubbish again, as always. And Matt, tell us about the last tune and why you've put it there. Why did you choose this for the last tune, Matt?
Well, this is a tune of Mario's called Mr. Day. And we all played it for the first time a couple of hours ago. And this seemed, when I had all the charts on the floor and I was looking at them all for inspiration, trying to think which one would fit for the set. And Mr. Day ended up being fourth on the list, so Mr. Day is what we're going to play. This is a groovy, funky tune, quite an uplifting tune that'll be fun to play by the fantastic Mario Kribe. So this is Mr. Day. Oh, and it's by John Coltrane, but the arrangement's by, I don't think John Coltrane played it in a funky hip-hop style, but Mario Kribe does. So, so this is Mr. Day by John Coltrane, arranged by Mario Kribe.
Go. Ready?
Okay, so we didn't over-rehearse that one. And I think we all finished together. and that featured the amazing Fergus McCready tearing the place up. And the amazing Matt Carmichael. Yeah. And the wonderful Martin Kershaw. And the fantastic Mario Caribe. And the long-suffering, enduring, patient, calm, and genius Matt Elliott. Matt, do you want to say anything to the audience before we have an interval?
I don't think I've got much to say of anymore, so.
I think you do.
Right, well, what to say? Yeah, hang around for the next set. We're going to play some tunes, two tunes by me and two tunes by Tom Bancroft. Yeah, don't have any. If you like the music of these musicians, support Martin or Tom or Fergus or Mario. Go buy their albums or whatever.
And they can donate.
And they can. Oh, of course.
And yeah. there's a link donate, underneath.
If you're enjoying this gig, you can donate at the PayPal link.
Or there's a link somewhere.
So I can pay back my pence. Tom charged me 75p for the use of his pencil, and it'd be nice to.
It's 75p per minute.
75p per minute.
Yeah.
And I spend a lot of time using pencils, so yeah, donate if you like.
We've got to make our money somehow. You know what I mean? So we're now going to hear from. By the way, thank you, Matt. Brilliant. We're now going to hear from the incredible Alan Benzi, who is coming next week with his own trio. So there won't be any of the Playtime regulars playing next week. It'll be with Stephen Henderson from Fergus's trio and the great Andrew Robb on bass next week. So let's have a wee interval and we're going to hear from Alan. My computer kind of blew up today, so this interview was done with no editing and it's 18 minutes long because I couldn't cut it. So if it's a bit longer than normal, I'm very sorry. But here we go, Alan Benzi.
Hey, Tom.
Alan Benzi, welcome to Interview 31. And because of reasons that we'll explain any second now, I haven't got time to edit this, so I'm just starting a timer.
Okay.
And when it stops, we're going to stop.
Okay.
Because my computer has been conspiring to make my life really difficult. And anyway, you look totally chilled and your background is almost as if that was designed to look peaceful.
The only bit of the flat that looks peaceful in any way.
where are you in the world?
So I'm in the West End of Glasgow.
Okay. And are you still in lockdown or what's going on with Glasgow? Level 3?
Yeah, still tier 3, yeah. So still being as careful as... I mean, gotta be careful in tier 2 as well. But yeah, so still the same situation. Not the anticipated change that people were celebrating early.
Yeah. How has the pandemic been for you?
I think it's been a mixed bag. You know what us pianists are like we're often quite happy just being stuck in a room doing, you know,
playing piano
away and doing that, you know, self-contained kind of thing. So yeah, and you know, it feels bad to say, but I think many people have expressed a similar sentiment, which was kind of at the start, I almost kind of appreciated the downtime to some degree. I think I'd been the busiest that I'd ever been in my life in the previous year or so. So, you know, in some ways appreciated the downtime, but as time has gone on, obviously, as said, when it starts to drag, doesn't it? So,
yeah, and there's also that feeling of what's going to happen to what we do for a living,
right?
If this doesn't significantly get back to some kind of normal, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I tend to be the kind of person who's kind of cautiously optimistic about that kind of thing, and I like to believe that, you know, there's enough strength there in what we do, and enough people out there who still want to see us all do it, that hopefully there's a resiliency there that I'm hoping that's true.
So, well, I hope you're right. And I think you probably are. I mean, jazz has always survived, despite, you know, rather than because of
right, exactly, yeah,
the prevailing economic conditions. It's not exactly ever, and I think actually because it's always been a little bit of an underground thing that people sort of had to do, whether they liked it or not, that it is very resilient. Although that's not like a cop. Like
Japanese, like Japanese knotweed, yeah, like,
Oh, I did want to ask you about Japan because apparently you speak fluent Japanese.
That is true. I mean, I'm hesitant with the word fluent because what does that actually mean? But yeah, I can have kind of everyday conversations and go around without too much difficulty. Yeah.
See, my best mate at uni was Japanese, and he told me that Tommaso Bancroftto means fat black pig in Japanese. And then I've since said that to Japanese people and they've looked blankly at me.
Yeah, that's definitely not true. Oh, yeah.
Sorry, my wife's just come home. Yeah, I'll be 10 minutes on.
Okay,
I'll clean up the mess. Okay. can you say... tune into Playtime, it's great, in Japanese for our Japanese ad, a cheap Japanese ad.
Yeah, I'm not sure of precisely what tune in is, but Playtime no tsuburashi shi, totemo ko tanoshii ongaku o mireru shi, mite kudasai. A bit casual.
Mushy, mushy.
A bit casual, but there you go.
Yeah, great. So how did you get into playing jazz?
Well, I'll try and do the not crazy lot. Yeah, I've got a tendency to ramble, but I'll try and not. Yeah, I mean, I think we, first of all, so we always had different music on in the house, and I think that's really important.
Right.
You know, so there wasn't a style of music, I don't think, that I was like, I don't get to do that, or that is bad music, or that,
right.
If you know what I mean. So I think that was helpful in the first place. And I started as classical violinist, and as far as I was concerned, that's what I was going to do. I went to St. Mary's Music School.
Okay.
Down at Haymarket there, to do that.
Right.
And then basically...
What went wrong? Something must have gone horribly
yeah, something
wrong.
Horribly wrong. The school, so once a month, Richard Ingham would come in to do jazz days, you know, where you could kind of... So each year group, or I think a couple of years together, would have like an hour of doing some jazz with Richard once a month. And I just absolutely loved it. I loved playing groovy tunes. I loved his energy and enthusiasm and humour. And I loved the chance to get my four bars of doing my thing. I said this before, and looking back, I don't think this was kind of very in the front of my mind, but I realise now, I think that I could kind of sense that many people were very uncomfortable with having four bars to do what they pleased with.
Yeah.
Whereas for me, I was like, it'd be more bars, I would like more.
Right, bass. Okay, yeah.
So that was definitely, I think, part of it, that sense that like, oh, like, I could get to decide what happens here, or we could get to decide what happens here together, and you know, that sense of kind of having a bit more ownership of the music and interaction and all that kind of stuff. So that, I think, appealed to me a lot. So Richard was huge for me. But you see, this shouldn't have had the jazz days at all, because then I went and said, oh, I want to do this properly for study, and what?
It was a nobody there going, no, you're ruining your life. You're changing everything.
Yeah, there was a little bit of that. My violin teacher, when I finally said I dropped the violin eventually, because you know, I knew that if I was going to get there with jazz piano, it was going to take a lot of work because I was pretty late to it. She just said, "But what will you do?" A question I'm still trying to answer to this day. But
we should get a little picture of her up there, just looking, disappointed.
She was a fantastic teacher actually, and actually, after I'd lost a lot of love for the violin, she managed to bring some of that back. I have to say, so I've got to give my props where they're due. But yeah, it was that the love of that did wane over time and the jazz. Oh, and I should also mention, so there was a boy a couple of years older than me called Jamie Chambers, who was quite good at jazz piano as well. And so I saw him playing and I was like, he's really cool.
So what happened to him?
I want to do that. So, I mean, I've not heard from him recently, but he's really cool guy. Makes loads of cool music.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, so I've not heard much detail recently, but he's one of those guys kind of, played different instruments and just generally super musical.
And is he a jazzer still, or is he?
I think, I wouldn't say like a jazzer. Probably more eclectic with things, but he was a good jazzer back then. So as I say, I was like, oh, he's so cool. I want to be like him. So those things were all in there, and I mean, but I'd grown up with a bit of Jan Garbrecht here and there, or something like that, kind of more from that side of things, and then started getting into all your, you know, Herbie and Bill Evans and all that stuff.
So how old are you now, Alan?
Oh, it's a closely guarded secret, in case you didn't know.
Well, could you give us a range? Between 18 and 50.
Yeah, I'm pretty much in the middle there, probably. Yeah, I'm 31.
Right, okay.
I know that I don't look 31. I look, you know, closer to the... No, but
I'm 31 as well. But I just,
right. So there you go.
I just hit it a lot harder and faster than... No, I'm not 31.
Well, here's my theory, because so that anyone that hasn't met me in person might not, but I'm about 5'3", and so I think all of the energy that should have been used for me getting taller just went into me remaining relatively youthful looking, which is not a trade-off I'm particularly pleased about.
Well, you know, the thing is, you can have that thing where you stay looking 14 or 16
right
for 30 years, and then one overnight you look 60, you know.
That's happened to
a couple of people I know, not naming any names, but
well, I mean, we still joke that, you know, that Fergus is still 12 or Matt is still 12, or, you know, the youngins.
There's, you know, that thing about who's going to play you in the movie. There's a friend of mine here, it was Jude Law, 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 Timothy Spall.
To be fair, if it's Jude Law, you're doing pretty well.
Yeah, it was Jude Law all the way through. Jude Law all the way through, and then, boom, suddenly Timothy Spall.
I have to think about that. Well, it would probably be Tom Cruise for me, only because he's famed as being relatively short, although I don't think he's actually that short, but... And then, Mr. Miyagi or something.
You mentioned Fergus and Matt, and as you, I think, probably are aware, this interview is being broadcast in the middle of their gig, and so the first set has just happened.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think of the first set?
Magnificent.
Okay.
Of course. I mean, there's no way it couldn't be.
Okay. You said that with a lot of confidence, almost as if you knew that question was coming.
Oh, as if I'd seen some of these before, perhaps.
I'm interested to know. I think you're probably, arguably, generation, not the same generation as Fergus and Mac.
Right.
So you were sort of like, I don't know how often there's a jazz generation, but there's sort of these sort of cohorts that come out, and there's the next kind of hot young cohort that comes out, and then we all used to be at one point were the hot young cohort, and then you become the sort of next up, and then the next up, and then you get to where I am, and there's like four hot young cohorts. But some of them are not as hot as they were. I don't mean, you know what I mean?
You don't mean physically speaking.
No. Well, in general, they're not as hot in that regard as well. But
yeah.
So like someone like Paul Tandreau is 40 now. And I can remember when he was sort of first on the scene and sort of, you know, Alan, Costco and, you know, Ryan and all that sort of generation. And so I'm wondering what it's like for you seeing Ferguson, Matt and that group coming up and getting some attention and how that feels for your age group.
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, I'd say I think I've been quite lucky because I've got to sit kind of between generations to some degree. Like you mentioned Paul there and, you know, I got to like do a wee tour with Paul early on when Steve was unable to make it in short notice. And, you know, I think it was him and Cosker and Mark Hodgson on bit. I got roasted. Oh. But, you know, and so like I was quite lucky when I was younger to kind of get to do that kind of thing from time to time and play with, you know, Colin Steele or whoever, stuff like
yeah.
that,
yeah.
and so on. But now also to have been asked to be in some of the bands of some of this kind of slightly younger.
Because you're in Fat Suit, aren't you?
That's right, yeah.
I love Fat Suit.
It's great fun.
Do you know the story about me at Bremen? This English jazz promoter sat opposite me at a cafe and just looked up and he looked at me and went, "Are you Fat Suit?"
No.
And I went, "No, I'm just fat."
Oh my God.
It was extremely funny, but it was a sort of disastrous social interaction.
Oh my God.
You could see his mind going, "He's from Scotland. He's fat. Oh, he must be Fat Suit." Yeah, I think Fat Suit are amazing.
It's great fun. Yeah, yeah. And I mean, so I joined the band a little bit later, but I went to see them play in Stereo in Glasgow. It's kind of under a vegan pub, basically. There's a venue down there. And I don't really know much, but, you know, I'd done a little bit of kind of teaching for and with some of the Strathclyde
right.
thing there. And yeah, I didn't really know what to expect. I was like, I've heard something snarky puppy something, right?
Yeah.
This lot. But I went along, so I was free. And it was, first of all, it was absolutely rammed.
Right.
And I went, it's a jazz gig, what's... And people were just having a great time. I had a great time. And I think very much a situation of, despite there being many people in the band, it's very much greater than the sum of its parts.
Yeah, okay.
I love playing in a band that's... that people enjoy that aren't necessarily your usual kind of jazz fans, you know, and then there's dancing and there's, you know, shouting and whatnot, so that's good. But I mean, I feel quite lucky in general to get to do different kinds of things. But as I was saying, sorry, going back to that, what you were asking about there.
Oh, time's up. We've got a couple of minutes to go. So just
cool. Well, I was just going to go back to that thing you were saying about generations.
Yeah.
And all I will say is, I just think if anybody is doing well here in Scotland, and if that's translating further afield, couldn't be happier. Like, obviously, I know Matt and Ferguson, a lot of the young guys, fairly well, and I just think I'm delighted to see successes.
Me too.
I think as you get older, obviously, you start to have a different perspective on what success means for you personally, and it's different for everyone.
Of hoping that it kind of translates into careers, because...
Exactly.
You know... The scene's quite, the industry's quite into looking at young talent and gets excited about them, but it's supporting them to grow into careers.
Totally.
Is, you know.
And I think that's partly true of the world at large. You know, we're excited by youth in general, people who are able to do things that most people their age
or aren't. People that look really young even though they're not.
And so that's a natural phenomenon, I think, to some degree. But yeah, as you say, I hope that translates into long-term success. I think it likely that in the case it will. But no, I think, as I say, as you get older, everyone has to decide what that success looks like for them. And it's different for everyone. And I think the main thing is you just try and get your life to be somewhere where you're some kind of happy. And if you can do that, that's what you want. So
what's the so next week you're coming with Andrew Robb and Stephen Henderson as a trio.
Yep.
It's going to be wonderful. What's the best thing for people to go online and listen to if they want to check you out before then? Where would you like us to send them?
Well, I mean, obviously, I think my own, my regular trio would certainly be by no means bad. Preparation is a weird, you don't need to prepare for it, but we'll maybe play a couple of tunes from that repertoire and we're going to play some.
Where's that Bandcamp?
I'm not on Bandcamp. Probably, I mean, you can check out my Facebook page, okay. Just Alan Benzie, pianist and composer. There's a kind of smattering of stuff there, but in the videos there's some trio stuff in there. Okay. And actually, we have, so I'm probably going to play a couple of more of a tune by a Japanese composer and my Polish pianist. There's some other things there that aren't my own stuff that I will do. And so there's a few things up there that you might get a bit of a vibe from that.
Great. And is there anything that people can buy online? Of course.
Yeah, I mean, I've got two records with my regular trio, which has Andy on bass, but it's a Hungarian drummer who lives in Switzerland right now. And so they can get them. Actually, the best way to do that is to go on my website, www.alanbenzie.com, and just send me a message through the contact page. I do actually reply to those. And so I can send physical that way, or if it's digital, then your usual iTunes and whatnot.
Okay, so they can buy on iTunes and that sort of thing. Yep. Great. All right, Alan, listen, thank you so much. I'm sorry about the technical hassles.
Oh, not
earlier.
At all, and pleasure, Tom. Thanks for having me.
It's great, and looking forward to next week. I'm going to be there, so I will see you next week, and I'll give you a call about arrangements before then.
Looking forward to it.
See you next week. Thank you so much.
Cheers.
Hello, Playtime viewers and listeners, and psychic people who are just experiencing Playtime through psychic powers. Welcome back to the second set. I hope you enjoyed the interview. I'm very excited because Ivan Clark said my hair looked good in the interview, and that's number 31, and that's the first time he said that. So thank you, Ivan Clark. I'll take any praise I can get for my appearance in any regard, even if it's slightly one of the... Anyway. We're joined, as you hopefully know, by the amazing Fergus McCready and Matt Carmichael, who are testing us and putting us through our paces as old jazz musicians that we are. And Martin said, speak for yourself. But come on, Martin. You're no spring chicken. So... Matt, would you like to tell us about this tune we're going to play now?
Yes, I could tell you about this tune. This tune's called Hopeful Morning. I do tell the same story on gigs, and it's not a great story. I'm trying to work out if I have the confidence to say it, but I'll tell the story. So I had to write a tune for Kevin McKenzie, composition class, who's maybe you've heard his guitar playing.
Never heard of him.
Rubbish guitar player. But basically for a composition class, we had to each write a tune based on a famous Glasgow landmark. And I wrote this tune. This is one of those tunes that kind of just came out in one go, which was nice. And then walking to RCS on the... Walking to RCS, I passed the Sainsbury's in Buchanan Street, and the tune is about the Sainsbury's on Buchanan Street, and the hope that Sainsbury's gives me in the morning. So this is Hopeful Morning.
Matt, I've just noticed that Kevin McKenzie's watching.
Is he?
No.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Carmichael. And that was called Hopeful Morning. And it was inspired by passing Sainsbury's on Buchanan Street. Is that right? Holy cow. On the piano, Fergus McCready. Ivan Clark said, it's a good job we didn't pass Aldi's. It doesn't mean anything. You don't have to worry about it. It probably would have been slightly different tune if you'd passed Aldi's, maybe. In Lidl's, they had a whole Ferris Sanders lifetime discography section the other week. No. It would be good if it was, wouldn't it? In Lidl's, the Central had the whole lifetime work of Ferris Sanders 1 week. Nice pastries. And on the saxophone, Martin Kershaw. And on the bass, Mario Kuribe. He's handsome. He's talented. He's from Brazil. What are you doing next, Matt?
We're playing a tune of yours, Tom. It's called Lucid Dreamers.
Oh, aye.
So would you like to tell us something about that?
Well, yeah, I mean, I wrote this in Tbilisi, and we went over there to do a gig with Kevin McKenzie's band, funnily enough. And, yeah. And I wrote this for the Georgian State Big Band to play while I was there. And then I showed it to them, and they said they didn't want to play it. There's a lot of stories. They kind of fucked us over. But anyway, we came back, and it lay on a shelf for 10 years. And then I then started playing it again. Well, it had never been played, so it sort of sat there for 10 years and then played it. And there'd just been a civil war in Tbilisi when we went there, so it's kind of about going through a war and coming out the other side, whether that's metaphorical or literal. And it's called Lucid Dreams.
Thank you.
Very much. That was Lucid Dreamers, dedicated to Ronnie Ray. And that featured the wonderful Fergus McCready on the piano and Matt Carmichael on the tenor saxophone and Martin Kershaw on alto saxophone and Mario Caribe on the bass. Now we're going to do one more of my tunes, and this is this was composed for a big band tour I did with Jerry Allen that Roz Rigby and Tony Dolly Evans will remember. And it's called Stanley and Marjorie's Jig. Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, that was the amazing Sogs Van, composed by the wonderful Matt Carmichael. We featuring the fantastic Fergus McCready. That segued after Stanley and Marjorie's jig. It's been a total pleasure having you guys come and visit us. Thank you so much. I know the audience have absolutely loved it. So thank you so much. And wow, you guys are so amazing. And you're still relatively young. It's not over for you anyway. Not like some of the people on the stage who are on the downward curve. And on Mario Caribe on the bass. And Martin Kershaw on saxophone. Yeah. And my name's Tom Bancroft on the drums and Baran. And really important and amazing Matt Elliott. He's done an incredible job. He's dealt with lots of technical problems tonight. And you probably won't even know. And our fashion guru roadie, Rory Dixon. I'm going to put a photo of him on the Facebook page later on. Please donate some money if you can to support what we do. One more round of applause for Matt Carmichael. We will see you. Well, there's a few comments. Great stuff. Lovely gig, Roz Rigby. Soaring stuff. Just keep going all night, please. Donna Andrews still watching. Superb musicianship all around. Thanks so much. Lots of claps and love hearts and everything. Relentlessly satisfying. That's quite good, isn't it?
What was it?
Relentlessly satisfying.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I'm going to put that on my on a t-shirt. wear it around the house. Tom, like a wee damselfly there. I've never been called that before. So thanks so much for watching. Thanks for all your comments. And we will see you all next week. Goodbye.